The PSE index traded with a negative bias on Wednesday as investors braced for the Fed's policy decision and the Banco Central's own meeting happening after trading hours today. The PSE index kicking off for this morning at 62.55. For more in the markets, we want to bring in Mark Canizales. He's head of equities for Manulife Investment Management and Trust. Hi, Mark. Happy holidays.
Hi, good morning.
All right, so the market has spoken after that critical Fed rate decision overnight. Big cheer from Wall Street spilling over into Asia today. Do you think we can sustain this kind of reaction, or should we be careful about setting ourselves up for a massive disappointment?
Well, I think seasonally the markets normally go up around this time of the year, except for last year. So last year, markets were down, I think, around 3% in December. But we've already seen the market move up about 0.5% so far. And the latest development from last night might actually extend to today in terms of this 0.5% rally that we're seeing so far for December. Mm-hmm. Again, I guess at this point, the market's already looking at 2024, what the expectations are. And people are already either starting to slow down in terms of trading or already positioning their bets for next year.
Mm-hmm. So how bullish are you about 2024? You know, because there is still the prospect of getting sticky inflation next year, because months ago we were told that the last mile was difficult. The BSP governor himself said that the off-cycle hike was about us playing catch up. So what do you think? Are we ready? Is the BSP ready to move in tandem, maybe even ahead of the Fed in terms of rate cuts? Or are we overpricing that, overestimating it?
Well, I think certainly the consensus is that rates may have peaked already, even for the Philippines. What the key risks that we are watching out for, of course, are on the CPI side. I think in your earlier segments, you've seen that El Nino is still posing a risk for 2024, and that certainly has the risk of inflation still being elevated if, let's say, rice prices go up or farm output actually drops. What's working for us recently is that oil prices have actually moved lower, mm-hmm. and that's helping the inflation print for November and also for October. But if that commodity goes up again in 2024, then you would see upward pressure on prices as we import most of our stuff. So those are the things that we are watching out for. But in terms of maybe inflation coming back to the central bank range of 2 to 4%, we are more confident that that will be achieved sometime next year or early 2025.
All right. On the plus side, I mean, we are seeing easing inflation, strong jobs numbers, our GDP really catching up by the third quarter, the BSP potentially on pause and maybe on cut soon. This sounds like a Goldilocks moment waiting to happen in 2024 for the PSE index. So what are you seeing for the index? What is your number? It seems like this year it's going to be another down year because we're still pretty far off from where we left off last year, 6,700, we're at 62.63. So it might be another down year. What about for 2024? What sort of gains yes. are you looking at?
Mm-hmm. So for this year, we're actually down. You're correct. We're down a few percent, like 2%, underperforming the major indices. But for next year, maybe what's working for us is that earnings is still expected to expand. But the risk there is that earnings is actually expected to slow down a little bit from the earnings growth that we are expecting this year. So for next year, we're looking at about a 10% earnings growth. So for this Goldilocks scenario to play out, I think at this point, the market is looking at specific catalysts that will push companies in terms of beating the numbers that is already expected of them. So historically, the market starts off at very high expectations for earnings growth at the beginning of the year. And then we see that steadily being downgraded. And that basically saps out the catalysts that the market is looking for to push prices further up, which is what we're seeing already at this point in time. So the fourth quarter, you're not seeing downgrades, but nothing is really being upgraded right now. For 2024, we're starting the year at a 10% earnings growth expectation. And what we would like to see as investors is that this number actually moves higher. So the risks that I've cited, for example, if that actually becomes less and less of a risk, that those would be powerful catalysts for a re-rating of the market. Because at this point, maybe if the market doesn't move up or just stays at where at current levels, we're starting 2024 at what? 10 times price to earnings for 2024, which is at very historical lows compared to the last 10 years, right? Mm. We're also cheaper compared to most markets. But remember, earnings growth for other markets, which are in the other thematics that are working, for example, AI, technology, all of these things, earnings growth is way higher. So we need to be more attractive or have something that will actually attract investors, especially foreign investors, for a market for our markets to re-rate.
All right. So maybe before, of course, there is no blind item for today. You know, when the market is so uncertain, nobody wants to give a blind item. But Mark, I wanted to ask, when you look at the environment for 2024, I mean, you talked about the risks and the opportunities. Who do you imagine will be the big winners and the big losers, even just sector-wise?
Well, in terms of sectors, the rate-sensitive ones are the ones that will benefit when rates start to come off. Or even not even go up further, are likely to be the ones which would have better earnings. So consumer staples, consumer discretionary names, most likely to have an impact because consumers are feeling inflation, the lesser incomes. Real estate is also expected to be a clear winner if rates start to fall because mortgage rates right now are quite high, which is preventing homeowners from actually looking at buying property. So those two sectors may be might be the clear winners for 2024 if rates start falling or even not move higher anymore.
All right. Just wanted to bring in some interesting corporate stories that we have. Bank lending was up 7.1% in October. That's a faster growth compared to September's 6.5% growth. Banks, how are banks looking at this point? Fully priced in? About to normalize next year?
Banks are actually one of the clear outperformers for this year, despite the increase in rates and despite loan growth actually slowing down on a month-on-month basis over the last couple of months. So this is a welcome change, the fact that lending is already up or even higher. Mm-hmm. Part of the growth is coming from the consumer side. You're seeing credit card loan growth accelerate, and also car sales or car loans accelerate. So that would be positive drivers. What we're waiting for banks in terms of a re-rating catalyst may be the other side of that loan book. So whether it's corporations starting to borrow or other loans starting to increase in the delta.
Right.
And that is likely to be triggered as interest rates start to fall next year.
Actually, you make a good point because outstanding loans for production activities grew by just 6% compared to consumer loans, which grew by 23%. So we want to see the other side also moving ahead. Also, we have this, Justin, from the disclosures, the Del Monte Group, reporting that sales grew 2% to $1.2 billion in the first half of 2024. Of course, they're using a different fiscal year. They're citing higher sales in the U.S. in the first quarter, but profit was lower because of higher costs. So nothing new, really. The top line is strong or okay, but it's really the costs from inflation that's hurting them. How about ASEN? ASEN has been in the news recently. They participated in the COP28 and Dubai Summit. ASEN has been inducted as a member of Global Group Powering Past Coal Alliance, PPCA, at COP28. Yesterday, we reported that it's partnering with ADB and BPI to raise 11 billion pesos in sustainability-linked term loans. How attractive would you say is the RE narrative at this point? Or are valuations stretched and have they fully priced in the potential already?
Well, I think in terms of renewable energy, the Philippines is still at the beginning of adopting cleaner energy. And certainly what we're seeing from power generation, power distribution companies, what they're doing right now are small steps that will basically enable us to also participate in this shift towards renewable energy. But of course, Philippines being the Philippines, our base load capacity is still predominantly coal. But what we like as investors is that there are already companies that are starting to be aware that there is a shift that's needed. You've seen the likes of even our power distributor also has its generation subsidiary that's starting to go into green energy. Some of the base load companies that are traditionally coal are also starting to look at greener sources of energy or even complementing what their existing baseload capacity is. So even for these coal companies or coal power generation companies, when you see the shift, given that they're predominantly on the coal side, once they add more of this renewable energy into their mix, the delta is actually way higher than somebody who's already into clean energy itself. But from a Philippine overall perspective, if you look at their overall generation capacity, if we start moving some of that to renewables, then it actually puts it at a higher ranking in terms of some of the other countries, because we're coming from, let's say, coal energy, and we're including renewable energy right now. So the delta is actually more on the Philippine side if you look at it overall compared to other countries. And that's something that I think is a powerful story to tell to investors, that the Philippines is also waking up and becoming a more introducing more greener energy sources to its energy mix.
All right. And on that note, Mark, pleasure speaking with you. It was good to see you. I will see you in the new year. All right.
Okay, thank you.
All right, let's have a profitable 2024. Before we zip through the top headlines, just wanted to bring in, we're 15 minutes into trade for the day, and the index joining the rally, up 0.8%, 52 points. We're at 63.07. All shares also up by 0.8%. So far, all sub-indices are in positive territory. So this might be it. You know, this Fed pivot and then the BSP's move later today might be finally the catalyst that helps the PSE index stay above 6,300, but still far from at least closing in flat territory, because the number to beat is at 6,700 plus plus. In the meantime, I want to go back just very quickly to our earlier story about Del Monte earnings for the first half, first quarter of 2024. Of course, they're using a different fiscal year. If you could just show the title of Del Monte, because I wanted to share again. So we did share that the group sales, we know that Del Monte is actually listed both here and in Singapore. The group sales grew by 2% to $1.2 billion in the first half of 2024, and they're citing higher U.S. sales in the first quarter. But the profit is lower because of higher costs. Not surprising, but here's the breakdown. We do know that for the quarter, the second quarter, they actually saw sales down 5% because of lower sales in the U.S. and lower exports of fresh and packaged pineapple by Del Monte Philippines, while sales in the Philippine market was flat in terms of dollars. In U.S. dollar terms, it was down 1% in peso terms. So that is for Del Monte. All right. Time